W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of The Children of Gods and Fighting Men by Shauna Lawless, narrated by Aoife McMahon.
Prologue. IONA Monastery, AD 981. Gormflaith. Amlaf's armor, sword, and axe gleamed as if new. His beard, washed and bathed in lavender-scented oils, glistened in the soft candlelight and curled elegantly over his chest. I leaned forward and rubbed my finger over his lips, down his cheek, until I touched the wolf fur cloak which covered the stone slab he lay upon. Only a stray lock of hair that had fallen across his forehead marred the effect. The nuns had dressed him well, but it was my duty, as his wife, to ensure he crossed over to the afterlife, looking like a king. I pushed the curl back, sweeping it into line with the others. Once satisfied, I smiled. Lying down, eyes closed, had always been the way I preferred Amlaf, but this was better. Death had a finality that sleep could only imitate. Death suited him in other ways, too. His right hand had stiffened to grip his sword tighter than I'd ever seen him hold it in life. He'd been a warrior once, true enough. But by the time my father inflicted this marriage upon me, Amlaf had been almost 70, his fighting days over. When his armies left Dublin to fight the Irish, he had gone with them. But I knew when the battle was at its worst, he sat on his fat horse while our warriors drew their swords. Well deserved, the warriors said, for Amlaf's reputation preceded him. The number of men he'd slain in his prime numbered over 1,000. No one dared to call him coward. Only old. Sinking into the chair next to Amlaf's body, I waited for the abbot to arrive. The monks had taken an age to dig the grave, rain and storms hindering them from their work. Last night, finally, they finished. I almost pitied them, though pity was wasted on the clergy. They'd chosen a life where misery was a virtue. If they felt closer to God by freezing to death on this hateful piece of rock, who was I to tell them otherwise? Not even the gold crosses that Amlaf had gifted to the monks, and which now adorned the altar, could give this miserable hovel any glamour. And somehow, the morning sunshine seeping in through the windows made the stone walls look more tomb-like than when lit by candlelight alone. I suppose I enjoyed the irony, if nothing else, that these same monks, knee-deep in muck, had once prayed fervently for Amlaf's death. The Viking King of Dublin, Amlaf the Red, had been a famous slayer of priests and raider of churches in his day, a scourge to the followers of Christ. And yet, here he was, converted, blessed, and absolved of all his earthly sin, as free to go to heaven as any of them. Of course, if Amlaf had been in his right mind, he'd never have asked the priests to baptize him. The horror of watching Ragnall die at the Battle of Tara had crushed him and turned him from the old gods. I remembered so clearly the day last year when Amlaf and his defeated army had returned to Dublin. Tears streamed down his face as he cradled his dead son in his arms. I hardly knew why. Ragnall had been a fool. But firstborn sons had a way of gripping their father's heartstrings that defied reason and forsook the children who followed. Our own sweet boy, Sitric, was only 8, was twice as clever as any of his other sons, and yet Amlaf had never noticed him. Sitric's face flooded my mind. My boy, my love, and so far away from me. Tears sprung to my eyes, though I brushed them aside before they could fall. Damn Amlaf for deteriorating so fast. It had given me no time to think. My only option had been to do as he asked and bring him to Iona, the sole monastery who had accepted his bribe for performing a Christian burial. It meant leaving Sitric behind, but I had no choice. Letting Amlaf die in Dublin had been out of the question. I didn't trust Gloniarn, Amlaf's eldest living son, not to slit my throat and burn me on the funeral pyre along with his dead father. King Amlaf would need a wife to fuck in Valhalla, he'd say. But I'd had enough of fucking Amlaf these last 10 years without facing the prospect of doing it for all eternity. Footsteps rang out as wooden clogs hit the stone floor. Quick steps. Good. It meant the funeral was about to start. I opened my eyes and smiled, a small one, half sad, half coy, more than enough to make the abbot blush. Tormenting the monks had been my only consolation on this hateful island, and it gave me no inconsiderable pleasure wondering how many self-induced floggings had taken place on my account. Is the grave ready? I said, once the footsteps stopped beside me. How should I know? I turned, straining to see the face hidden by the dank early morning gloom. Mother? Is that you? The figure stepped closer, and the familiar golden eyes of Ethlyn, former Queen of Leinster, came into view. A black cloak shrouded her body, and a veil covered her hair and mouth. For once, she was dressed appropriately for the occasion. What are you doing here? I hissed. Two of Amlaf's men are outside. They might have recognized you. Mother waved away my concern. I've come to speak with you, and less chance of being spotted here than in Dublin, don't you think? I straightened and suppressed the scream reverberating inside my head. Mother never came to see me unless she brought ill tidings, and seeing her the day of Amlaf's funeral made the fluid in my stomach freeze over. My thoughts turned to Sitric. His half-brothers wouldn't have hurt him, would they? Not a boy. As violent as Gluniarn's rages were, he'd never vented them on children. But then, no other child in Dublin was a son to the dead king, and born to a woman who wasn't his kin. My voice shook, not heeding my wish to appear calm. Has something happened to Sitric? Mother tutted. Honestly, Gormla, you can't let yourself get into such a state over your mortal children. You will see many of them die over your lifetime. You need to harden your heart and heed the advice I give you. A strange expression lit Mother's eyes that made me curious enough to bite back my reply. Besides, arguing with her always ended up with me saying something I regretted. Perhaps a different tack would be better today. I passed my hand over Amlaf's body. Have you come to tell me you were right? About what? Her eyes narrowed. Amlaf didn't live long, just like you promised. I suppose I should be grateful. So you should. The marriage I arranged for you made you Queen of Dublin. Shaking my head, I gritted my teeth. You married me when I was 13 to a man older than my great-grandfather. Did your golden necklaces and brooches not compensate? She caught my sideways glance and sneered. You think you understand pain, but you don't. You knew me as a queen, but only 2 years before you were born I was a slave, captured from Normandy by Viking raiders. The great Murcha MacFionn, King of Leinster, bought me. From the moment I laid eyes on him, I could see his teeth had rotted away and his hair was gone. Did I care? No. I thought of nothing except how to become his wife. And you succeeded. Good for you, Mother. You think such matches are easily made between kings and washed-up urchins?
It was unheard of for a woman so low to marry a king. You have no idea how hard it was to persuade him. The things I had to do. If you did, you wouldn't complain about Amleth.
She tapped the silver pendant hanging around her neck. The sound of her nail hitting the metal thudded dully in the damp air.
How many years was he even able to hump you before his strength failed anyway? 4, 5? That's nothing.
I'd had to lie under Amlaf's rancid body and smell his foul breath right up until 6 months ago. Though there was no point complaining to Mother about that. Father had been every bit as grotesque as my husband. How strange that I could see that now. The anger I usually had balled up inside me evaporated. I didn't look at Mother with resentment anymore, rather understanding and pity. Yet I could not allow those emotions to sway me. Mother was up to something, scheming, and no doubt, once again, I was the unwitting pawn. Well, no longer. I was not a naive 13-year-old girl anymore. Shrugging, I smoothed Amlaf's fur blanket. It doesn't matter. Amlaf is dead. Father is dead. And, oh yes, aren't you also meant to be dead? I remember your funeral. A grand affair, you'll be pleased to hear. Even High King Seniel attended. Mother said nothing. She only stared at the engravings along the blade of Amlaf's sword. I tried not to let my grin widen and pushed on. So why are you here? I thought you would have found yourself a plump Frankish lord to marry by now.
Raoul is dead.
The raw pain in Mother's voice dampened my joy at her discomfort.
She loved her sons, I'd give her that.
Mal Morda, my full brother, had been pampered and praised as if he were a god. And Mother spoke of Raoul, a distant half-brother I'd never met, in such glowing terms that when I was younger, I had imagined him to be Achilles himself. How did he die?
The descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann came for him.
My chest thudded, and a momentary paralysis stilled my lungs. I'm sorry for you, Mother. Truly. I know you loved Raoul. But I don't see why you risked being spotted to tell me in person. A letter would have sufficed.
No, not this time.
Mother pulled her veil away. I waited for her long black curls to spring forth, her crowning beauty, so my father had said. But they didn't come. Thin wisps of white, thread-like hair lay lank against her scalp. I reached out into the darkness, and the flame on the nearest candle shot up, the fire rising high and wide, licking the damp walls and hissing as the moisture touched it. Under the glare of the bright firelight, I took in the face of my mother. Wrinkles pulled at her once smooth cheeks, and the skin beneath her eyes sagged. The way Fomorian descendants aged was strange. We lived hundreds of years in the bloom of youth, and then in the last year, age rotted us like over-ripened fruit.
Stop it, Gormla,
my mother snapped. There's no one else here. I knew it to be true, but put my hand down anyway. The flames receded. So you're dying? For real, this time? She nodded.
300 years is all I've been given. I have until the summer, I think.
My throat tightened as if I had just swallowed something too large. Though Mother stared at me, chin held high, I knew she was upset. Do you need anything?
No. I've joined the nunnery here and paid the nuns enough gold to ensure they look after me until I pass away.
She shuddered and shoved her white hair back within the confines of her veil.
No need for you to witness all that.
Folding my arms, I gave the slightest of nods. Perhaps I should insist I stay. Wouldn't that be the dutiful thing to do?
But the truth was, I had no desire to watch her die.
Amlaf's death had been painful enough, and the gods knew I'd prayed for it to happen at least once a week since our wedding night. Then what do you want?
To give you some advice about how to raise your children. Should any of them be like us?
My head rolled back, a deep, nervous laugh erupting from my mouth. It bounded round the empty church, echoing into the distant dark.
I'm being serious.
Mother grasped my hand, and for once I saw fear swim within the eyes that were always so cold.
60 children I've had, 50 of them born mortal, but 10 of them with magic. We are Fomorians, descendants from the line of King Balor himself, with the fire magic in our blood. You and your brother, Malmorda, are all that remains of our kind. Once I die, you two will be the very last.
I snatched my hand away. And whose fault is that?
Mine. I can see that now.
She bit her lip.
It was the descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann who struck the fatal blows, yes? But it was I who didn't teach my children how to use their magic properly. I didn't teach them how to be careful.
I breathed out slowly. Hearing Mother admit her guilt was a strange and unnerving thing.
I was arrogant in my youth,
she whispered.
My brothers were alive then, and I was convinced we would kill the descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann. We planned to attack their fortress. But they found us before we could discover where it was. None of my children lived long. Neither did my brothers.
And yet you got away. Mother nodded.
You judge me harshly for that, I can tell.
The wooden cross hanging at the top of the chapel caught my eye. There was a small wooden man pinned to it with a crown of thorns on his head. It seemed there was no shortage of parents willing to sacrifice their children to achieve their own ends, to save themselves. I have asked you to tell me about your other children before, and you always refused. Why now? Mother drew a deep breath.
I want you to know that I haven't made the same mistake with you. I taught you how to control your fire magic, and I married you to a king. You may not have liked Amlaf or your father, but they cloaked us. The descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann do not mix with the royal families anymore, especially not the Viking ones. It gave me the time needed to teach you and your brother how to hide your power.
Mother lifted her chin as she spoke, defiant as always. She stared at me straight in the eye.
That is why you're still alive.
Will I be much longer? I held her stare, not crumbling as I had when I was a child.
Or have you come to tell me the Tuatha Dé Danann descendants tortured Raoul and know where we are?
Mother gripped the back of the chair with both hands. At first I thought fatigue ailed her, but then the shaking of her skirt caught my eye. I had never seen her tremble before.
Raoul never gave away my identity, or yours, or your brother's.
How can you be certain?
Because I killed Raoul before the descendants reached him.
My breath stuck in my throat.
I had to.
Mother hushed.
He was one of us, but he was a drunk and wouldn't listen.
And I had to protect you. Malmorda. Her voice lowered to a whisper.
I hid when they came. I saw them stand over his body as he choked on the poison I put in his wine.
You saw them? In the flesh? The hairs on my arms stood on end. The Tuatha Dé Danann were warriors so dangerous that no Fomorian has ever survived an encounter with them. That my mother was the first made me almost forget how much I disliked her.
Well, what did they look like? What did they say?
Very little, One was called Tomas, fair skin, blonde hair, and green eyes, dressed in red silks and fur. The other's skin was black, with dark braided hair and green eyes. He dressed in monk's robes. Brother Coleman, he called himself. Remembering the scene, her eyes filled with tears, and she stared off into the distance. Standing quietly, I waited as she collected herself. They think Raoul was the last, she finally said, her voice now regaining its strength. It must stay that way. You must remember how to hide. Follow the rules I taught you.
I took her hand in mine. She pulled back to take it away, but I held it tight. I'm sorry about Raoul, but there is good news here too. With these descriptions, Malmorda and I can search for them. There can't be many places in Ireland that would hold them all. Mother frowned, eyes now refocused, and her fingers turned rigid between my palms.
My time is up, Gormla, and the task of finding the descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann lies with your brother, not you.
I nipped my lower lip between my teeth and let her hand fall away. So, how long do I have before I must fake my death? 10 years? 20? The bitterness returned. This was the other fate my mother had dealt me. Every woman in Ireland prayed at night for beauty and a long life, all except for me.
They were my curse.
Mother examined my face.
10, if you're lucky. 20, if you're a fool. That's how the descendants catch those who conceal their fire magic. Remember that. Just the mere whisper of a man or woman who isn't aging, and they send one of their warriors to check. They can sense the Fomorian fire within us. They're warriors. They can smell it.
So I need to lie low and marry. Then 20 years later, pretend to die and escape undetected. Over and over, I must do this until old age catches me.
Is that your great final advice? Yes. And no.
That wasn't the answer I expected. Despite myself, I felt the warm glow of curiosity grow.
Marry, breed, move on, were the words she'd drilled into me.
This deviation surprised me, enough to let the expression colour my features. Mother smiled, the wicked twinkle in her eye shining once more.
If your brother becomes High King, he will have the authority, the wealth, and the army to wipe out the descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann forever. If you can...
Mother, I shook my head wearily. It won't work. Malmorda isn't even King of Leinster, and even if he was, a King of Leinster has never been crowned High King before. Mother stepped closer, her eyes widening.
Ireland is changing, Gormla, and the wealth of the Viking ports is behind it. If Malmorda has the Viking warriors of Dublin on his side, who is to say the High Kingship is not possible for him?
My heart stopped for a beat.
You want me to help Malmorda?
Not you, she scoffed. You will have moved on before all this happens. I mean Sitric. You must help him become King of Dublin before you leave. Then he can assist Malmorda with his plans.
No, my boy won't be a pawn for your ambition.
My mother sighed and gave me one of those frowns akin to rolling her eyes.
You will learn the truth of it before long. You may love your mortal children, but they are not the same as us. They live for the briefest of moments. Like a butterfly, they are pretty to look at, nothing more. If they can somehow help us, well, all the better. They're good for little else.
My son is precious to me.
I've said all I can.
Mother stepped back.
Your brother will be in contact. If you have any love for me at all, you will help him. And if Malmorda succeeds and kills the descendants, you can stop running too. Think of that.
Mother's footsteps echoed across the church. No hugs or kisses of farewell, just like all the other times we had parted company. I sat on the chair and let Mother's news ferment in my mind.
Damn it, but I was sick of being nothing. A woman beholden to male plans. No. No more. Sitric was more than what Mother said. He was everything to me. I loved him. In truth, he was the only thing I had ever loved.
And so I would make him a king, but not for my brother like she wanted. And I wouldn't leave him after 10 years either.
I'd make Sitric powerful. Save him from the pain of being forced to marry or fight where he didn't wish. I'd give him what my mother and father had not given me. Freedom.
Time passed, though I couldn't say how much, when footsteps once again hit the stone floor. Many steps. Some that shuffled, some that marched. I glanced up to find that the abbot and Fawk, Amlaf's master shipbuilder, had come into the hall.
The burial is due to take place, my queen,
the abbot said, simpering as he bowed.
Good.
I pulled my cloak tighter about my shoulders. Ready the boat, Fawk. I want to leave as soon as possible.
Then we must go now,
Fawk said grimly,
before the tide turns.
Very well. The abbot's mouth gaped like a dead fish.
We haven't buried King Amlaf yet. Surely you want to see him receive his absolution and burial prayers.
I held out my hand for Fawk to take and gave the abbot a hard stare.
No.
No, I don't.
Aware his mouth was still hanging open, I marched out of the church. It was time to go. My son needed me. Burying the dead was no longer my concern. 11 years later. Wicklow Mountains, 992. Fola.
Fola, I need you.
I opened my eyes.
Ronit? What was she doing here?
Staggering out of bed, I threw off the blanket and reached for my shawl.
Fola, hurry, I need you.
The door rattled, straining against the rope that fastened it to the wall. The last vestiges of sleep that clung to my body instantly disappeared. Something was wrong. The hour was late, and Ronit had sent no message to tell me she was coming.
Hold on.
I jumped over the dying fire in the middle of the room and untied the rope. The door swung open.
Ronit, what are you?
I ran out, arms wide, ready to embrace my older sister. But only the cold midnight air greeted me.
Ronit?
I peered into the distance. The full moon illumined the river and damp grass with its ghostly pale light, but my sister was nowhere to be seen. I stepped a little closer to the riverbank, stood on a boulder, and scanned the boglands that lay between my rock and the mountain ridge.
Ronit!
I shouted again.
Where are you? What's wrong?
The night was not silent. Wolves skulked in the forest. Enna snorted against the stable door, and leaves rustled in the breeze. But for all that, the land seemed suddenly devoid of sound. The absence of laughter and chaos that my sister always brought with her made it so.
Sister, can you hear me?
I paused.
Is this a trick? You're scaring me.
No reply came. Shaking my head, I walked back to the raw and wrapped my shawl tighter around my chest. I must have been dreaming. Yes, a stupid dream. What was I thinking? There was no way Ronit could be here. The council had sent her to the nunnery at Lusk only last winter. Tomas wouldn't allow her to leave there for at least another 2 years. And if she were in trouble, there were other places she could go that were closer than here. I slammed the door behind me and reattached the rope to the wall hook.
I was an idiot. It was freezing, and for once I'd fallen asleep without taking one of Tomas's potions. Now I would never get back over. Any other night it wouldn't have mattered, but tomorrow I had a long day of travelling planned. The path to the Descendants' fortress on Fennet Island was straightforward, but the provinces were always fighting. Concentration was required to stay clear of the mortals and their skirmishes, and I could do without being exhausted before I even started. Crouching by the fire, I stoked it with a stick. It was almost out, though not beyond redemption, and I grabbed a handful of kindling. The smoke thickened as the hot cinders took hold of the new fuel, rising into the room before disappearing through the thatch.
Fola!
The door rattled.
Sister!
I stood.
What is going...
The rope snapped away from the wall hook and the door slammed open, shattering against the wall. A howling whirlwind rushed into the house, loud as thunder and cold as a winter storm. It blasted against me. The table and chairs lifted, spinning and crashing against the walls and thatch. I grasped hold of the corner wall post and curled around it, pressing my body into the wall.
Come to me!
The voice wailed.
Ronat!
I screamed.
What's wrong? Sister!
The voice howled.
Come to me!
I couldn't answer. The wind pounded me so hard I couldn't catch a breath, and my legs and arms were sliding away from the post. I couldn't hold on or breathe. When I woke, I found myself face down in the middle of the room, lying where the fireplace should be. Except it wasn't there anymore. The stones that once surrounded the pit had been flung into every corner. Some were even outside. Everything was still now, quiet. I raised my head slowly, pushing away the bundles of thatch that covered my hair. The wind had carried Ronit's voice. My legs buckled as I tried to stand, and I half crawled, half staggered to the bed. No descendant of the Tuatha Dé Danann had enchanted the wind for hundreds of years. Ronit was a powerful witch, I had never doubted that. But the wind had its own words and did not bend easily to the will of another. Heart pounding, I sat and then stood before sinning again, hardly daring to breathe while I waited for the wind to return. The wind did not return my patience. Instead, it stilled. That was it then. That was the message. Ronit needed my help. I grabbed my dress and cloak, picked up my bag and ran to the stable. Enna, we need to leave. The large mare snorted, shoving her nose into my hand. I gave her an apple in a quick hug, then mounted her. Go, Enna. Find Ronit. Not needing to be told twice, she bolted out of the stable, and together, we made our way along the path to Leinster. The sky brightened as we approached the hill bordering the Nunnery of Lusk, the sun burning away what was left of the morning cloud. Enna had kept her pace through the night, her magic ensuring that she didn't tire, but suddenly she slowed. Come on, I whispered, we are almost there. Enna snorted, her whole body tense. And for a moment she refused to move. That was when the smell struck me. Dismounting, I bent forward to avoid the contents of my stomach emptying over my dress. It wasn't just the stench that turned me. It was the knowledge that came with it, for I had come across burning flesh before. The Viking raids over the last 200 years had targeted many of the monasteries and nunneries, and they tortured more than a few abbesses and abbots into revealing the whereabouts of their hidden treasure. The council had allowed the healers to help the mortals then. I hauled myself back onto Enna.
Ronit is there,
I whispered into her ear.
We need to find her.
Enna cantered forward. On cresting the peak, my eyes confirmed what my stomach knew. Smoke drifted across the grass, large flames still burning the wooden frame of the small church. The nunnery's outbuildings lay in ruins. The wattle and post walls were blackened by fire or else collapsed, and the building's interiors exposed.
Dead bodies covered the ground, as lifeless as the rocks behind them. I counted 7, which meant a great deal more were inside the church. Racing down the hill, I didn't let Enna stop until I reached the first of them. I dismounted, rolled the nun over, and peeled away the headscarf, feeling carefully for signs of life. Her body was cold, her pulse extinguished. I ran to the next body, then the next, examining each of them in turn. Every one of them had deep stab wounds to the chest and stomach. Dried blood pooled underneath them, their life force long since gone.
Ronat, I shouted. Can you hear me?
The reply I longed for didn't come. Standing, I sprinted inside the church and slid past the blazing wooden beams around the porch. My flesh burned, but it didn't matter. My gift as a healer meant any burns to my skin and scalp would heal in an instant, and I could bear any amount of pain to find my sister. Nuns lay in a heap beside the altar. The corpses closest to the burning roof had turned black from exposure to the flames, skin and flesh melting like candle wax. Vomit rushed up my throat. What if Ronit was one of them? No, I couldn't think that. She wouldn't have waited in the church like a lamb for slaughter. She would have found a way out. I ran past the corpses and through the door that led to the bedrooms, checking every smoke-filled corner. It wasn't until I found the food store at the far end of the building that I stopped. The damp mud walls had prevented the fire from spreading here, and I used this respite from the flames and smoke to unlock the back door and swing it open. Fresh air rushed into the room, and I gulped it down. Now I could breathe. I noticed the thick layer of ivy covering the surface of the door and thatch. It was burnt on the outside, but the thick sap and groundwater had prevented the fire penetrating further. Ronit must have cast a spell to stop this room burning like the rest of the building. Filled with hope, I searched the store. Behind the grain barrels, there was something. A body. I ran over to find a small woman. Wisps of dark brown hair poked out from under her headscarf. Ronit! Falling to my knees, I turned her over. She was in a bad way. Every inch of visible skin was badly burnt, and blood congealed around her ears and nose. I pressed my ear against her chest. The faintest of heartbeats tapped against her breast. Descendants of the Tuatha Dé Danann did not die easily in battle, but we could still die. Flames and swords. That's what my father said to me when I left his raft for the first time, and poor Ronit looked as if she had endured both. I picked her up and dragged her outside. As soon as the air was clean enough to breathe, I set her down on the grass and removed the outer layers of her clothing. Thick blood saturated her hair and scalp from a gash across her head, but her neck and chest were not cut, and the burns were confined to her arms and legs. She was all right. She was still breathing. I could save her. Ronit, I nudged her gently. Can you hear me? She didn't respond. Sister, don't worry. I am here. I pressed my hand against the cut on her head. My gift flowed through me and into her. Wounds began to seal, veins and arteries healed, and broken bones mended. Her breathing steadied. Fola, she croaked, her eyelids flickering open. You found me. Of course I did. Ronit gulped down a breath and squeezed my hand. I wanted to hug her. Only the weeping flesh on her burnt shoulders held me back. She was in agony. Red and black blisters covered her charred fingers, the skin over her arms pink and raw. I pressed my palms over the wrist and watched as the skin gradually reverted to its usual creamy white. Inch by inch, I moved my hands along her arm. Sister, what happened? Men attacked at first light. And they came hard and fast. I begged my friends to leave the church. To hide. Her voice trailed away as her eyes closed tight. Do you know who the men were? Dubliners. I hadn't expected this answer. The carnage matched the Viking style, to be sure. However, in the last 20 years, the Dubliners had stopped raiding inland. The gold made from their trading business along the Mediterranean and with England by far outstripped what they could steal from the Irish holy houses.
Are you sure it was Dublin?
I asked. Perhaps it was a Viking crew from Norway or the Isles? Ronit coughed.
No, it was Dublin. I recognise their leader. Sitric, they call him. Sitric Silkbeard.
The name was familiar. I'd attended enough council meetings with Tomas to know the names of those in power and those who one day might be, though this Sitric had never been talked of with much importance before, just a younger half-brother of Gloniarn, King of Dublin. A raid on a nunnery will not go down well with the Irish kings, I mused. King Gloniarn, no doubt, will deny it's him. Ronit gave a wry smile.
Oh, King Gloniarn didn't order the raid. Sitric did this with his own men. But he's been caught out. One of Gloniarn's warriors, Aegle, saw them do it.
I bent down, moving closer to Ronit's face. The red blisters on her cheeks had disappeared, replaced with tawny freckles that danced along her nose. But her eyes were still heavy with pain.
Are you sure you're remembering this raid?
I didn't bother to hide the doubt in my voice and felt again for fractures on her skull. Ronit had always been terrible with names and understanding political motivations, but Tomas would want to know the truth of it. A raid on a nunnery by the King of Dublin was significant. An ad hoc attack by a jealous younger brother seeking glory, less so. A raid by outland Vikings, almost meaningless.
I'm sure. I've met Aegle many a time.
She gave me a lingering stare, her eyes widening before quickly looking away. Her hands moved to wrap around her stomach.
He used to come here often, before I told him to stop.
Ronit, what do you mean?
I knew exactly what she meant. I had felt another presence about her, something other.
My hands moved to her stomach, pushing past the thick fabric of her cloak.
You lay with this Aegle?
I could hardly bring myself to say it.
You lay with a mortal man?
They are not so different to us.
They are not the same as us either. The women may be kind enough, but the men are consumed by greed and deceit. They are beasts.
Those are Tomas's words, not yours.
Ronit lifted her chin a fraction.
Don't you remember when we were young? And we played with him before the council forbade it. Don't you remember how we all laughed together?
I shook my head. The memories she spoke of were almost 100 years old, and now was not the time to dig them up. Pressing my hand over her stomach, I felt for the lining of her womb.
4 months?
She bit her lip.
More like 5.
Damn it, Ronit! You're supposed to be spying for the council and reporting to Tomas if anyone important comes to the nunnery.
I wiped the sweat from my forehead, giving myself a moment to calm down, but it was no good. There was no way to undo what she had done. Her fingers moved forward to touch mine.
Fola.
I snatched my hand away. You say they are not so different, yet the fire only proves they are. First men set it alight, then this Aegle. Watched the nunnery burn, knowing you and his unborn child were inside. What a coward. It proves every bad thing the council taught us about them.
Ronit shook her head. Aegle tried to save me but couldn't get in. He is a good man, Fola. Truly.
My sister's hands moved back to her abdomen, rubbing gently.
I saw the baby in my dream the night after I first met Aegle.
She closed her eyes.
I had to give my son life. Can you feel him kicking? He's already eager to be a part of this world.
My mouth dried and I sat back into the folds of my cloak. The joy in her voice only made the knot in my stomach pull harder. My personal distaste for mortal men was one thing, but there was a more pressing concern.
To lie with the mortals is against the law, Ronit. Remember? The council will punish you.
I know, and I'm willing to take it.
I can bear anything as long as you're not angry with me.
Exhaling, I pressed my fingers against the last of the burns on her neck. The skin knitted together, and after a moment, the scars disappeared. I'm too relieved you're alive to be angry. I just wish that you wish that I had found one of our own kind to be with. I nodded. Love doesn't work like that, Fola. Ronit stared at me solemnly. If it did, you would have married Tomas a long time ago.
Don't change the subject.
Ronit rolled on to her side. Fine, I won't talk about Tomas. I know it's painful for you, but the council laws change nothing. My child was meant to have a mortal father. The whispers on the wind told me.
And who is it that whispers on the wind? I snapped. Perhaps the voices you hear are not good ones. Did you ever think of that?
Ronit laughed. Her strength returned now I had finished healing her. Oh, many voices speak to me. Some good, some bad. I'm well enough acquainted with them to know the difference by now. The wind doesn't distinguish between descendants and mortals. There was a time when we didn't either. A time when you didn't.
A long time ago, when I was a child and didn't know any better.
I stroked Ronit's hair and shifted to sit beside her, too tired to speak anymore. Using my gift to heal someone this close to death was draining. Try to remember. Her voice softened. There was one young man, Colum, who lived in the rath at the foot of the mountain. He sang every morning and gave all the extra food to his younger sisters. He helped every beggar who came to his door. I've never seen such kindness in anyone, descendant or mortal.
Yes, I remembered him. I remembered his songs and gentle nature. I had admired him just like Ronit. But this was not my last memory of Colum. I had another, one of him lying against a raw wall, a spear in his side, his eyes forever closed. I had never told Ronit, perhaps I should have.
Would the knowledge that Colum had been murdered have helped her to see?
It should, yet I didn't think so.
She had lived in this land for as long as I had. War blighted every corner. So much death, so much chaos, so much hate. So much that she refused to see.
You were there when the new agreement was passed, Ronit, same as me.
I stood and swept the dirt from my dress.
You know why the new laws were made.
Ronit frowned. It was the wrong decision.
It was the only decision the council could have made.
When we lived among the mortals, we grew to love them too much, took different sides in their wars, and ended up killing each other. Tomas was right. We had to withdraw, or else our own kind would have diminished further. Ronit rubbed her chin. We have mortal blood in our veins too. We should not be denying ourselves the love of our own kin. Your daughter...
Don't bring Aoife into this.
My words came out hot and fast, and Ronit's smile faltered. I'm sorry. She pulled me into a hug. Let's not argue. My body sank into her arms. An overwhelming urge to cry took over, but I didn't want her to see me like that. Not again. Come, she said after a few moments. We must go to the fortress. You can't be late for the gathering, and we must tell Tomas what has happened here.
Maybe you shouldn't come.
Understanding what I truly meant, she pulled out of the hug and kissed my cheek. I can't run away and pretend my baby doesn't exist.
You could go into hiding and give him away once he's born. No one needs to know.
Ronit sighed and took my arm in hers. Knowing my sister as I did, I said no more. And we made our way to the front of the church, where Enna was waiting. Tears fell on Ronit's cheeks as we passed the slain nuns who lay on the grass. The smell of blood and burning flesh filled the air, their faces stricken with fear and despair. Ronit stopped to cover them and whisper words of farewell in their ears.
I'm sorry, Ronit, I said, as I helped her cover one with a cloak.
She brushed her tears away with her hand. No one deserves to die like this. I agreed and watched her in silence as she covered the last of them. I wondered that she could see all this and still defend mortals. How had she even been able to speak with this eagle, let alone go to bed with him? Mortal men were beasts. Everyone said so. But that thought made me think of Aoife, and the tears they had held back earlier spilled over. I had pulled myself together by the time Ronit had finished. The skin around my eyes felt raw and swollen, but Ronit was too lost in her own thoughts to notice. And once we mounted Enna, we plodded along the path in silence. Ronit didn't talk. I wanted to speak to her, but worry weighed my tongue. I hoped that Tomas and the council would be lenient. Ronit hadn't tried to interfere in the Mortons' lives, after all. She hadn't incited violence or given advice on any wars. But what about the baby? He would be born mortal, like his father. What would happen to him? The questions rolled over and over, the answers never revealing themselves. And as we moved closer to the fortress, my chest tightened. The wind returned once we crested the hill, hissing and wailing as it swept through the forest beside us. Branches creaked, leaves rustled. And there was something about the way it wailed as it blew around the trees that reminded me of a child lost, crying out to be found. Dublin, 992. Gormla. Glonearn sat on the throne in the great hall. He sipped at his wine, leaning into the smooth wooden spires rising from the back of the seat. It wasn't really a throne. It looked nothing like Charlemagne's throne in Paris that my mother had told me about, decorated in gold and silk. But Glonearn was the King of Dublin, and I suppose a king could not say he sat on a chair like the rest of us, even if it was carved from the same wood as all the other benches in the hall. He drank from a silver goblet, at least, and the black cloak he wore was the finest I'd ever seen. The traders from Norway told him they cut the hide from a bear so big the cloak didn't need to be sewn together from pieces. It had cost him a hefty price, one that Glonearn was only too happy to pay. The cross that hung from his neck was exquisite too, solid gold and embedded with gems. 2 years after he fell out with his father for allowing the priests to baptize him in the Liffey, he had followed suit. Not for the love of Christ, he wasn't that stupid, but for the love of trade. The kings of England, France, and Navarre would not deal with us unless we swore allegiance to their God, or Christ, as they called him. And what better way to prove a conversion than by adorning oneself with the fruits of the trade permitted? Yes, I had to admit, the overall effect of the golden jewellery and expensive attire was impressive. He looked like a king, even if he didn't sit like one. I raised my glass to him and flashed a smile. He returned the gesture, locking eyes for a moment longer than was appropriate. Citric collapsed onto the bench beside me, a cup of ale in one hand and the waist of a slave girl in the other. She giggled as she fell into his lap and leaned forward, pressing her plump breasts against his chest. "Your brother knows about the raid," I whispered into his ear. Citric shook his head. "He doesn't. You're paranoid." Biting into a piece of honeyed bread, I pinched the slave girl on the arm. "Bring me more wine." She stumbled off, face flushed, though her smile grew once she realized Citric was still watching her. I sighed. "Really, Citric?" My son shrugged.
"I'm only doing what all men my age do."
"As long as you know you're all doing it with the same woman." Citric rolled his eyes, but his gaze shifted from the pretty slave to the gold arm ring on his wrist. Amlaf's arm ring. I placed my hand on his shoulder. "Forget about her. We've more important things to discuss tonight." Sitric nodded and stared at the top table where Gloniarn, Gloniarn's wife, Moor, and their older children were seated. The eldest boy, Gilla, was 12 summers now. He reminded me a little of Sitric at that age, already tall and strong. Spoiled, though, far too spoiled. Sitric's gaze didn't stray like mine. It remained fixed on his half-brother, the king.
"Have you seen Gloniarn and Aegle speak since he returned?"
he whispered.
"No, but Aegle may have sent him a message."
Sitric didn't reply. He was annoyed with me, and I understood why. The raid on the nunnery had been my idea, one that he had been reticent to agree to. But I could not apologize. Sitric needed experience leading, to get a feel for which men he should trust, and more than anything, he needed gold. He'd raided several trading ships over the last few months, dangerous, for they were crewed by warriors. Yet the stolen treasure and dead men were easy to blame on rogue Viking bands that prowled the shoreline for potential slaves. The nunnery had been a change of tactic, a test. Many warriors rankled at the thought of killing women, even more so when in cold blood. Sitric could not afford such sensitivities. He needed to be like his father, Amlaf, who'd killed many women in his time. Ruthless until the end, it was no coincidence that, in his 80th year, he had remained the King of Dublin. Sitric didn't know that I had followed him. For what son wants their mother to watch while their darkest deeds are underway? The watch him I did. I watched as he and his men sacked the nunnery, watched as they set it alight, and watched as their swords pierced the veiled women's chests. And that was how I knew someone else had been watching. Aegle, hidden within the forest to the east of the nunnery, had taken it all in too. Though I couldn't work out why. Was Gloniarn having Sitric followed? Or was it a coincidence? Either way, it wasn't good for Sitric. Aegle was a bastard of Amlaf's dead son, Ragnall, and loyal to his uncle. There was no way he wouldn't tell Gloniarn what Sitric had done. The only question was how fast he'd do it. A shame that I hadn't been able to find Aegle earlier, for now he was surrounded by his friends, and any quiet word I might think to have would be overheard.
"No,"
Sitric said at length.
"Gloniarn doesn't know."
"How can you be so sure?" I asked, curious that he sounded so certain. Sitric was clever, but sometimes clever men fell into the trap of being overconfident. Sitric rubbed his thumb over the arm ring.
"I understand my brother's nature better than you. He hasn't found out. If he had, he wouldn't be so happy."
I pursed my lips. Perhaps the marriage he has brokered between Mura and High King Seniel pleases him. It's a match all the provincial kings wanted for their own sisters and daughters. Gloniarn is on the rise. He has every right to be pleased tonight. Sitric shrugged.
"Gloniarn and High King Seniel are half-brothers. The fact that Gloniarn has married off his half-sister to him isn't as big an accomplishment as everyone makes out."
"Oh, but it is," I said. "Mura's mother was the only daughter of a traitor. Seniel will know she is of low breeding, and yet he took her anyway. The wealth of Dublin is hard to say no to, even for a high king." Sitric examined his brother, then shook his head.
"It does not change my opinion. Strength and power do please Gloniarn, but having the chance to put me down is what he lives for. If he knew for certain, he'd be brewing and thinking of how best to humiliate me."
I took another sip of wine. In days gone by, I would not have worried so much. It wasn't like Gloniarn's hands were free from the stain of nun's blood. However, the shiny golden cross hanging around his neck came with new responsibilities. For a Christian king couldn't allow raiders to plunder nunneries so close to Dublin without reprisal.
And what better retaliation would there be for Gloniarn than using the incident as an excuse to kill a true-born, younger brother with two eyes fixed on his throne? Maybe you're right, my son. However, Aegil did see you. If Gloniarn doesn't know now, he will before the night is over. Sitric's face paled, and he slammed his cup of ale onto the table.
I was a fool to listen to you. It was too soon to raid inland.
You listened because it was good advice. It's not my fault you didn't scout the hills to check for witnesses. My son scowled, and his knuckles turned white. Fear clouded his judgment. I needed to make him see it was this fear that was holding him back, and that he needed to let it go. Thumbing my glass of wine, I examined the room until I found someone suitable. It didn't take long. Sitric, do you see Wolf over there? Sitric followed my gaze. What do you think of how he has lived his life?
I've never thought about Wolf's life. Why should I now?
I hardened my voice. Because I'm your mother and have asked you a simple question. Sitric begrudgingly did what I asked.
He has no wealth, but he seems happy.
I nodded. He is happy. He earns enough carving bowls, goblets, and plates to keep food on the table. His wife loves him, and he has five sons. Many would say the gods favor him. Sitric gave a half-hearted smile.
Wolf is a good man. I'm glad for him.
I'm glad, too. The thing is, though, this time next year, he'll still be in this hall or in the market selling his wares. His life will never change between today and the day he dies. He is a free man, yes, but he must do as Gloniarn says. To be truly free, you must have power. And to have power, you must be king. Sitric met my stare, his eyes full of thought. What do you want, son? You either want to be king of Dublin, or you don't. However, once you make a move on Gloniarn, there is no going back. If Wolf's life appeals to you, that is fine. But you have a choice before you. You'd better make it. Sitric's voice softened, and once again he glanced at his arm ring.
You know what I want, Mother. I shouldn't need to tell you again.
Reaching forward, I brushed my finger against the golden band on his wrist. On his deathbed, your father insisted I give you this, the first one he ever won. He knew you had a great destiny. Sitric flushed. So, I said, raising my goblet to my lips. Now you know what to say if your brother questions you about the raid. Thumbing his arm ring, Sitric leaned forward and rested his arms on the table.
I should admit it was me.
Yes. There is no point lying. Best to use the situation to show the men of Dublin you are not afraid of your brother.
There will be a fight if he finds out tonight.
Sitric stared at his brother.
He has drink on him. He'll challenge me to meet him at the square.
Can you defeat him? Sitric lowered his head and flexed his muscles. He was like an ox, well built for his age, and already skilled with the sword and axe. Gloniarn was a talented fighter too, but he enjoyed the lifestyle of a king too much. A widening waist attested to that. I had no doubt who would win. Sitric didn't look so certain.
Maybe.
You are more skillful, faster too. Your tutors have told me as much. Sitric nodded.
Yes, but he has experience on his side. And luck.
My heart pounded against my ribs. Perhaps the risk, if they were to fight, was too great after all. Any warrior could be felled if he turned the wrong way or got caught by a well-timed punch. Amlaf had told me that himself. And yet Sitric had to make a move soon. He was too popular with the warriors, and Gloniarn had noticed this. Better a fight in the square than a knife in the back.
I rubbed my hand over Citric's arm. Well, it may not come to that. First, we must discover what Aegil's intentions are. Go now. Speak with the men outside by the fire pits. Make sure they notice you. Be their friend. Charm them. I waited until Citric was outside before I stood. I heard the men standing around the fire pits cheer as he walked over to them. They were Dublin's fighting men, but those not wealthy enough to feast inside the hall. Citric would need their support tonight if Glóniarn challenged him. If nothing else, they would ensure the rules of the fight were adhered to. My focus changed direction. Aegil sat on a bench at the other side of the hall, next to the fireplace. The friends that had surrounded him earlier, now gone. Surely, there was something I could offer him in exchange for his silence. I stood and walked past the top table. Glóniarn sat in the centre, his wife Mór to his right. They both smiled as I passed. I said nothing, even though Glóniarn's expression seemed to invite it. Aegil, I said as I approached his bench, how are you this fine evening? My late husband's bastard grandson, red-faced and unsteady, spat on the floor.
I've been expecting you.
I opened my eyes wide. Have you? Giggling, I sat. I hope it's to tell me something exciting. He scowled, a strong line of tension tugging at his jaw.
I have. I tried to save.
He broke off, his words slurring as his arms thudded against the bench. The anger in his voice caught me unawares. It wasn't like him to get upset about killing Christians. I'd seen him raid with Amlaf when he was a boy. I remembered him laughing when Amlaf murdered the Bishop of Glendalough. Leaning forward, I took his hand. Whatever is the matter, Aegil?
Citric raided the nunnery at Lusk. His men killed all the women there. All of them.
His fist banged the table, knocking over his cup.
There was no need.
The noise attracted a few stares, but I exaggeratedly waved to a slave girl to mop up the spilled ale while I wiped at the splashes on his tunic. See? Just another drunk man. The curious looks faded. It's not like you to worry so much about murdered nuns. I hushed. They are dried up old hags with foul breath and no hair. Everyone knows that. Tears filled Aegil's eyes.
One of them wasn't like that.
He slumped forward, catching his head with his hand just before it crashed into the table. You knew one of them? I searched my memory. Sometimes daughters of mixed marriages in Dublin were sent to the nunneries. Their Irish mothers or fathers seemed to believe the Christian God listened to their prayers more if one of their children was an eternal virgin. But I didn't know of any that Aegil had shown an attachment to.
She was beautiful. Sweet. Not like a nun at all.
Aegil steadied himself and met my gaze.
Citric shouldn't have done it. Glóniarn has forbidden raids on holy houses. I thought she was safe.
I frowned and filled his cup once more. Aegil, forgive me. It sounds so strange for you to love a nun. Besides, what sort of life is this? The grandson of a king should not be sneaking off every night to bed a nun, when he could have any woman he wanted.
That's what she said.
Aegil's head lowered once more into his hands.
3 months ago, she told me to stay away, to find someone else. But I couldn't. I only thought of her. I went yesterday to ask her to marry me. And that's when I saw Sitric and his men killing.
He gulped at the contents of his cup, and once more, drunken desolation took over. Hiccups and sobs intertwined, and I gave him a moment to set his sadness free.
I'm sorry for your loss, Aegil,
I whispered into his ear.
But please, don't tell Glonearn. He'll kill Sitric at the smallest provocation. And Sitric only wanted to raid like his father. He never had the chance,
the way you did. Aegil wiped away another tear, but I couldn't tell if my words were going in.
What do you want, Aegil?
I peered up at him from under my eyelashes.
It breaks my heart to see you so sad. You've always reminded me of Amlaf, you know.
You look just like him. Aegil downed the rest of his ale, wiping his chin with his sleeve.
A wife, a family, respect, love. I almost had it.
Clutching his arm, I pressed him closer to my body. These things are all for the taking, Aegil. You need not sneak off to the nunneries to find women.
There are plenty here who would have you. Plenty who desire you. I gestured down the table to where a Sitric slave girl was tidying away the empty plates, guessing full well what his reaction would be.
Tha!
Aegil sneered, slamming his fist on the table.
A slave? I'm the grandson of a king. I deserve better. But Glonearn won't let me marry high.
That's because he fears you.
Aegil drank, his heavy eyes opening a fraction wider.
He does, I continued. You have your father's looks. Glonearn doesn't want the men seeing you as a leader.
We can change that, though, can't we? I refilled his cup with wine from the middle of the table, which was much stronger than the ale he'd already gorged on. I held out my cup and raised it high.
To getting what we deserve.
Aegil rested his head in his hand and gulped it all down. I sat beside him and waited. In no time at all, he slumped forward, fast asleep. Now it was time to go. In the early hours, I'd return and wake Aegil. I'd convince him to rest in my house, which was closer to the great hall than his. And, once there, persuading him to do what I wanted would be straightforward. I made a show of leaving, waving goodbye to the other ladies from Amlaf's extended family, and walked home. It was cold inside my squalid little house. I closed the door tight and wrapped myself up in my furs, the ones that Glanyarn's wife hadn't stolen before I returned from Iona, and held my hand over the kindling sitting in the fire pit. A flame ran down my fingers and the kindling burst into flames. I didn't need to light it, for I never felt the cold. Mother told me it was our Fomorian blood that kept us warm. The rain and wind irked me, as it did the mortals, but I did not shiver and wilt like them when the winter air blew in.
Fire, though. Oh, I loved the feeling of flames close to my skin.
Smiling, I lay on the bed and lit a candle. I should have been tired, and yet now a fire was dancing beside me, I felt more awake than ever. I watched it move, mesmerized by the shapes made by the flames and smoke, and let half the candle burn before I stood and opened the door. The noise from the great hall had vanished, though the shouts of the men by the fire pits now replaced it. I heard Sitric's voice often. Someone had started a wrestling competition. These were always popular, and from the sounds of it, a great deal of gold was being wagered on the outcome. Tiptoeing out of my front door, I wrapped a scarf over my face and stared at the great hall. The doors were open, and it appeared empty, aside from the outline of Aegil still slumped over the table. I weaved my way past the houses built around it, using them to shield me from the eyes of the men by the fire pits. When the next fight finished, they erupted into cheers, and I ran from the shadows, up the steps and through the open doors. The fire in the center of the hall was almost out, and the only light came from the torches attached to the wall. As expected, the room was empty, save for Aegle, who snored into the wooden table. Deciding it would be best that no one saw me helping him to my house, I closed the doors. I didn't want another to offer him a bed in their house. That wouldn't do at all.
Ma, Gormla,
a deep voice murmured.
I was wondering if you would show up.
I glanced at the far end of the room to find Gloniarn walking out of the passageway that led to the bedrooms in the back. Damn it! Why was he awake? Had he found out? He ambled over to the throne and sat, grinning at me all the while. Were you? I strolled over to him. I can't think why. He put a finger on my lip.
I am glad you are here, though not for the reason you think.
Intriguing. I sat beside him and poured myself a cup of wine. I offered him one, but he declined. A large leg of lamb still lay on the table, and I pointed to it. Gloniarn gave me a small nod, and I picked up the sharp knife beside it to cut a slice of meat away from the bone.
I have a marriage proposal for you,
he said. The succulent cut fell away, and I stabbed it with the tip of the knife, then placed it in Gloniarn's mouth. A line of pink juice dripped from his lip and into his beard. I hadn't expected this to be the topic of our conversation. He'd asked me to marry him once, many years ago. A drunken mess, he'd forgotten all about it the next day, and I'd no intention of reminding him. But what to say now? It might suit me to keep him in my pocket until Sitric had more experience. Gloniarn swallowed.
Torna, uncle to the King of Ulland, has asked if he can marry you. I've said yes.
Marriage? To an outsider? I buried my scream. It would be a mistake to give him that reaction. And more likely than not, Gloniarn was toying with me. Oh, I couldn't marry Torna of Ulland. I'd miss Sitric too much.
Sitric is a man now. He needs a wife, not a mother.
I grinned as I raised my eyebrows. So, you have a marriage in mind for my son too? Who is the lucky girl?
Sigrid, daughter of Vidar.
Vidar? The fur trader? Gloniarn nodded.
It is a good match.
It was a terrible match. So terrible I didn't know how Gloniarn had kept a straight face when he said it. Vidar was a traitor, but a poor one, with one ship to his name and an aging crew. He knew then. He knew what Sitric had done and wanted me out of the city before he killed him. I cut another slice of meat. I stabbed it once again with the tip of the knife and this time placed the meat in my own mouth. Gloniarn smiled as I chewed and swallowed. What about your need? I asked. I can't believe you'd give me away so easily. Gloniarn laughed.
You are pretty, Gormla. I have enjoyed you, but I must make more alliances to prevent the King of Munster raiding our lands. I expect Torna to arrive here tomorrow, and the wedding will take place the day after.
His voice had sharpened enough for me to know he was being serious. Bastard. He wanted to separate me from my boy. Without me here to protect him, Sitric would be dead by the end of the year, and I wouldn't let that happen. Tell me, I said sweetly, is this Torna rich? I cut another chunk of meat and, using the knife, fed it to him. It won't do if he can't keep me in the luxury I became accustomed to with your father.
Poverty doesn't suit me.
Gloniarn laughed as he took the meat into his mouth and ground it with his teeth.
You amuse me, Gormla. That's why I like you so much. You're as greedy as me.
I set the knife on the table, then swept my lips against his neck.
Oh, I think not. I'm much, much greedier.
His right hand slid along my calf, rising slowly until it reached my thigh. A raucous bout of cheering erupted from outside as his hand brushed the hair between my legs. The men were calling for a fight to start.
Cedric,
they called, their shouts demanding that my son enter the square. I moved my lips from Gloniarn's neck to his lips, kissing him over and over. His free hand reached to tug my scarf away from my neck and unfasten my pinafore. I pushed it away, placing it on my other leg while I loosened the scarf for him. He nodded, understanding what I wanted, and watched me until the fabric came free. I clambered over the seat, spreading my legs so I could sit on his lap. His eyes closed as our lips met. Taking a deep breath, I rolled the freed scarf into a ball and silently picked up the meat knife with my right hand. He panted, waiting, anticipating. Eyes still closed. I lunged forward and thrust the blade through his neck. Then I pierced his eye, then his throat. With my left hand, I held the scarf over his mouth, stabbing over and over. I pressed my body against his, using the thick wool to dampen the sounds of his screams, until there was nothing but silence.
What have you done?
I spun around. Stumbling towards me was Aegil, his sleepy eyes widening as he stared at the bloodied corpse of his uncle.
You fucking bitch!
He staggered towards the doors of the hall, tumbling over his own feet. I held my hand out. The dying fire pit suddenly burned hot, and a firebolt shot out from the coals to collide with his face. Disorientated, he fell onto his hands and knees. Yanking Gloniarn's sword from its sheath, I ran and thrust it into Aegil's side, twisting upward. He thudded to the ground, blood pouring from his wound and mouth. Life seeped away from him even before he understood what had happened. I'm sorry, Aegil, I whispered, shakily pressing the bloodied meat knife into his hand. But if you want something, you must take it before somebody else does. His body slumped forward, relaxing like a sail with no wind. I was glad the knife did not slide from his hand. His father would greet him in Valhalla now, for Amlaf had always been fond of Ragnall's bastard children, and Aegil, out of them all, had been his favorite. I stepped back and pressed my hand against my chest. What had I done? The king was dead, so was his half-brother. But I had saved my son.
Dada?
A sleepy voice called out from the bedrooms behind the hall. Quickly, I examined the dead bodies. A fight had broken out between them. Yes, Aegil was angry and jealous. Gloniarn, rash and hot-tempered. There was no one else around to say otherwise. And Cedric had been fighting outside for hours. Not even a fool would think of blaming him. Throwing my blood-soaked scarf and pinafore into the fireplace, I watched them catch fire as I fastened my cloak and ran towards the doors.
Dada!
The voice called out again, this time louder. As I slipped outside, another cheer broke out. The men were calling Cedric's name. My son had won his fight.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.